this beautiful, warm summer morning in Southwest Florida, wildlife biologist Mark Danaher of the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service is visiting the Florida Panther National Wildlife Refuge, a small but critical piece of the wildlife corridor puzzle. A puzzle that connects adjacent private and public lands in Florida's ever-developing landscape. This more than 26,000-acre refuge is located in the core of occupied Panther territory, just 20 miles east of the city of Naples in the upper segment of the Fakahatchee Strand in the Big Cypress Swamp. Established in 1989, this refuge and the staff tasked with its management protects the core habitat for the endangered Florida panther and all native wildlife who roam within the apex predator's habitats. Numerous female panthers call the refuge and adjacent natural areas home. One of the most well-known panthers on the refuge, due to her easy-to-identify tail, is affectionately referred to by staff and visitors alike as Broketail.
Broketail's, just really unique in the fact that, you know, we would consider her a resident female because, you know, she was born on the refuge. She's had multiple litters on the refuge, and she really just hangs tight on the refuge. But she also goes over to Fakahatchee Strand, Picayune Strand State Forest, and Big Cypress National Park Preserve pretty regularly.
Through the use of wildlife cameras and other innovative monitoring measures, service staff and their local partners work closely together to collect and document a wide range of important migratory and mating patterns that are helping biologists, legislators, and other concerned members of the public better understand the needs of the Florida panther and how they can help protect the species.
I've had the opportunity to work in just about every state from Texas to Virginia, and working here in South Florida, one of the most interesting and fascinating things that I've found has been the amount of partnerships that we have here in South Florida. And you've heard the old saying, it takes a village. And, and one of the most rapidly growing human populations in the United States, not only do the conservation lands and us land managers have to work with one another, but we work across the aisle and with so many other different partners, whether it be nonprofit organizations to state organizations like FDOT.
I'm Brent Sutchel with the Florida Department of Transportation, and FDOT's mission not only involves the safety of the motoring public, but also the preservation of the environment. But we do that by installing wildlife crossings. And we're fortunate here in Southwest Florida to have State Road 29 and I-75 Alligator Alley that have numerous wildlife crossings adjacent to the Florida Panther National Wildlife Refuge and the Big Cypress National Preserve that allow wildlife to safely cross from one side of the road to the other. That's not only important for motor safety, but also for, you know, the wildlife safety and that connectivity, connecting one habitat of the Florida Panther National Wildlife Refuge over to the Big Cypress National Preserve.
Through these efforts, research shows panther numbers have increased over the past two decades, and estimates now have the population at 120 to 230 adult individuals. However, while some males have ventured as far north as Georgia, females have largely remained in Southwest Florida, including Broketail.
Broketail, to me, she's like the ambassador for the importance of protected conservation lands, protected conservation lands, and also the importance of wildlife crossings, because that allowed Broketail to successfully raise all three of her kittens to dispersal age, and most importantly, two female kittens to dispersal age, because that's the factory, if you want to think of it that way. Those females can go on to reproduce and help continue to grow the Florida panther population here in Florida.
Wildlife crossings serve a dual purpose. Not only is it for the safety of both the motorists and the wildlife, you know, to preventing those wildlife vehicle collisions, but also it allows habitat connectivity, allowing wildlife to safely cross under or over roadways, you know, without having to worry about being, you know, hit by a vehicle. Luckily, long before my time at the Florida Department of Transportation, folks had the foresight to install the wildlife crossings on State Road 29 and Alligator Alley. And I want to continue that success that we've had. We have a lot of wildlife crossings that are planned in the future. We have one just north of the State Road 29 crossing, north of the Panther Refuge that we have planned. That'll be a new box culvert crossing there. We have another one up on US 27 that's near the town of Venus. We call it the Venus Wildlife Crossing. That'll connect future conservation lands there. It has great Florida black bear habitat, as well as deer and other wildlife utilized in that area. And then up at I-4, we have a crossing that's actually under construction. It's getting close to the end of completion. That'll connect the Hilloche Wildlife Management Area. And that corridor, I-4, is a major roadblock for wildlife. But for the Florida Panther, it's so important for them to expand their home range out of South Florida, get them north of the Coosahatchee River, and eventually north of I-4 up into the Green Swamp.
The Florida Panther Refuge is approximately 26,600 acres, and the home range of an adult female panther can be upwards of 70 to 80 square miles. So, and an adult male panther can be upwards of 200 square miles. So the Florida Panther Refuge, even though it's only 26,600 acres, it doesn't even meet the requirements of an adult female's home range. But that's the beauty of South Florida and having connected conservation lands across the landscape, because collectively, the Florida Panther National Wildlife Refuge, Big Cypress National Preserve, Fakahatchee Strand State Preserve State Park, Picayune Strand State Forest, Everglades National Park, the list goes on. We have upwards of 4.1 million contiguous acres of protected conservation lands here in South Florida. So this particular crossing, we documented Broketail and her kittens when they were older, trying to navigate under the I-75 crossing. It was obviously the first time that they had ever gone through this wildlife crossing at that older age. And as you can hear with the sound that of the traffic traveling behind us now, it can be pretty intimidating, especially not only it's intimidating for us just standing here, but intimidating for an animal like a Florida Panther that's not used to that sound. And so it took her hours to finally coax her older kittens to traverse under this wildlife crossing. But the coolest part of that, it was a true teaching moment. We normally don't, especially as a biologist, think of teaching moments between wildlife. But what we've been able to document, and our partners at FSTOP and FGCU Wings of Hope Panther Posse, what we've been able to document with our trail cameras have been true teaching moments of in particular, Broketail teaching her kittens that it's okay, it's safe to go under this noisy highway to get to the other side of, you know, where there's more conservation lands. So it's been an amazing journey watching that unfold, and we normally haven't been able to see that long-term story of a Florida Panther unfold like we have with Broketail and her kittens. So it's been remarkable, to say the least.
When I saw the amazing shots, and I didn't even know, you know, I think I'd known the name of Broketail, but I'd never really paid attention to it. But seeing her trying to get her kittens to cross the State Road 29 crossing was just amazing. And the patience that she showed. And, you know, again, you had the one kitten was just like, you know what, yeah, let's do it. You know, I'm going across and you know, whatever, I'm going through. And the other kitten was like, well, I'm not sure, but, you know, the other one went, so I guess I could try this. And then, you know, the last one was like, I'm not having it. There's just no way. They just were not going to cross. And, you know, the patience that the mom showed, you know, Broketail showed, and, you know, calling to her kittens and trying to comfort them. And, you know, you have overhead traffic going on and strange noises. There's bats that live underneath the bridge, and, you know, they have guano and stuff that smells funny underneath there. And, you know, just, you know, there's water underneath there, and just showing again the patience that she had and the, you know, the hours and the time. But she knew the importance of those crossings. She knew that it was important for their safety, for them to be able to successfully go for, you know, for their lifetime. So I'm sorry. It was just fascinating to see how a mother would be able to teach her kids to do that. I think it just really hits home for me of the importance of the wildlife crossings and the work that we do, you know, to make this happen. You know, it's, you know, we work hard every day for these things, and it's really, when you see that video, it really hits home, so.
To get back to the partnerships, you know, it does take a village, and we do work with one another, and I love that aspect of just how many interactions I get to have and to work with partners like Brent Setchell at FDOT and every other nonprofit and every other state and federal agency that occurs. It's really been a fascinating experience for me, and I've been doing this for 25 years. And just to see those partnerships in action, not only to plan, but actually to see those plans come to fruition, it's amazing. And to me, it's very gratifying as a biologist to see, you know, we can plan all that we want to do, but just for those plans to actually come to fruition is a completely different story. And to me, that's the greatest aspect of these partnerships that we have with FDOT and everybody else that we have partnered with here in South Florida.